May the God of our Lord, the Almighty Father, give you wisdom and peace, his comforting spirit, that you may know his love, that you may know his riches, that you may know his mighty strength.
To the praise of his glorious grace, of his glorious grace. Good morning, everyone. Am I live at this point? Anybody hear me okay? We're good. Okay, the man at the back has his hand up, so that is the sign that I am audible. Excellent. So welcome to all of you. However you are here today, you're here in person, it's very nice to see you all. If you have any visitors with us, you are especially welcome. Please come and make yourself known to us later. If you're joining us online on Zoom, also welcome. If you're joining us later on Facebook, we extend that welcome as well. And we ask that however you are here, we are pleased that you have come into the house of God. And we ask that you will feel his presence and be aware that you have been in his presence during this time of worship. My name, for those of you who may not know me, which is probably an increasingly small number, is Malcolm Hayes. I'm one of the deacons here and one of the members, and I'll be leading the service today. Our sister Ruth will be bringing us a message later. We start with just a few notices. The major one is for Stay and Play, which is where we open the church up to parents and their children to come and, as it says, stay and play. It's a very good way of getting people associated with the church in a non-threatening and entirely enjoyable way. But to do that, we need help. And we need helpers. It'll be taking place in August, the 2nd, let me get this right, 2nd, 9th, 16th, and 23rd of August. If you can help in any way, I was going to say please see Jenny, but she's not here today. So have a look at the board on the back of the wall here, directly in front of me, and there are plenty of little post-it notes to offer your services in whatever you feel you can do. If you can't actually be present on the day, then please offer your prayers that the mechanics of this thing will go well, that God will use it as a way of touching people's hearts, getting them more associated with the idea of church. And Paul gave me a little notice just before I started, which I think is worthy of notice. It's an item from the Courier. I don't know if anybody saw it yesterday. I didn't, I must admit. But it says on it, "Preschool strikes gold. A preschool in Leamington has been awarded a gold rating when it comes to helping children with special needs and disabilities. Little Stars Christian Preschool, based at Leamington Spa Baptist Church, apply for the award, which recognizes high quality provision. Despite this being their first application, staff will be delighted to receive a gold award." So I think that's worthy of a sort of small round of applause, I think. So I have the little item here if anyone wants to read the details afterwards. Little Stars is an important outreach from us, and they do a great deal of good. You notice when we had the barbecue, there were a lot of Little Stars children there, and together with their parents. It's another form of outreach. And it emphasizes Christian values. It is a Christian preschool. So worthy of celebrating that wonderful little achievement. So we come to our time of worship. Over the last few weeks, we've been looking at the book of James in the New Testament, one of the less famous books, I suppose you say, not like Corinthians or Colossians. Something which is not read that often. But nonetheless, we think it has valuable lessons to be learned. And the recurring theme that's been coming out of this is wisdom. And later on, Ruth will be bringing us the message from James based on the title Wisdom with People. Now, the ultimate source of wisdom is God. But no one taught him wisdom. He didn't acquire it himself. As it says in Isaiah 40, who can fathom the Spirit of the Lord or instruct the Lord as his counselor? Whom did the Lord consult to enlighten him? And who taught him the right way? Who was it that taught him knowledge or showed him the path of understanding? So when we come to worship, we need to remember who it is that we are worshiping. It's a self-evident statement, but it needs to be said occasionally. God is not like us. We are made in his image, but not the other way around. And we must be careful never, unconsciously or consciously, to try to reduce God to the level of human understanding, because he's beyond that. He has wisdom completely beyond our knowledge. As it says in Isaiah 55, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. So we need to remember that. And when we come into his presence, like today, we need to come in an appropriate attitude of awe and wonder. This is so great a God, but nonetheless, he accepts us as his children. He takes delight in our worship. It's a wonderful thing. So let us pause in the presence of this Almighty God and remember who we are worshiping before we start. Let us pause. Our Father, we acknowledge that you are the source of all wisdom. There is no one like you. You are greater than anything we could possibly imagine. And yet you still care for us. You take delight when we bring you praise. You allow us to call you Father. Grant us a glimpse of your greatness as we worship you this morning. Amen. So we start our worship with singing. And I've chosen the Psalms based on that theme of wisdom and the greatness of God. After each song, I will allow a time when, if you feel so moved, you can offer a prayer of worship yourself in whatever language you feel comfortable. If you'll feel so inspired by what we have been singing. So the first is a good standard, good old hymn. Immortal, invisible, God only wise. As it says here, it's the acknowledgement of the greatness of God and his wisdom. So please stand or sit as you feel able. Immortal, invisible, God only wise.
Glorious.
most blessed, most glorious, almighty, victorious. God, your great name we praise. You are from everlasting to everlasting, and we come before you in awe and wonder and offer our worship to you. Amen. Our next song is Who Can Know the Mind of Our Creator? As I said earlier, we cannot know the mind of God. His ways are not our ways. And as the song says, we just stand in awe of him because of this. Who can know the mind of our Creator?
Thank you.
Our final song in this section talks about the perfection of God, his faithfulness, and the fact that he is a just God. Because of these things, we should ascribe, give greatness to our God. Ascribe greatness to our God, the Rock.
Oh, Lord, we do glorify your name. You are perfect. You have perfect wisdom. And we're going to bring our prayers now for others, to this God who has perfect wisdom. James tells us in verse 5 of chapter 1 of his letter that if any of us lack wisdom, we should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault. And as we're looking at wisdom this week, we think of Solomon and how the Lord gave wisdom to him. He asked for wisdom, and just as James said in the verse I've referred to, he did give wisdom to Solomon abundantly. And let's pray that the Lord will give wisdom to us too, as we pray to him, that we will recognize his will and be able to pray according to his will. So let's now pray for our world. We pray, Lord, that you will give wisdom to the leaders of our world. The decisions they make have far-reaching consequences. And so we pray, Lord, that the decisions they make, both for their countries and in their dealings with other countries, will be guided by you and according to your will. And where there are leaders who may be guided and driven by their own personal desires, such as ambition or greed, we pray, Lord, that you will give them a change of heart, that they will want to work for the good of all and for your glory and not just for themselves. We pray for areas where there's conflict, and we think particularly of the continuing war in Ukraine. Lord, we ask that you will bring peace to those who are suffering as a result, people on both sides of the conflict. We think too of the ongoing problems in Syria and the Middle East. And Lord, we pray that you will bring an end to the conflicts there, an end to suffering and peace. We think of those who are facing famine in Africa as climate change causes increasing drought. We pray, Lord, that you will give a willingness amongst the wealthy nations to do more to support them, and wisdom to all who are fighting to tackle the climate crisis, and willingness by all, including ourselves, to take action to improve things. We pray for those who are persecuted for their faith, and indeed people who are persecuted for many other reasons too. We ask, Lord, you will work in the hearts of regimes and individuals who are responsible for that persecution, that they will recognize that you and what you're doing through your people are not a threat, but that you are working for good. We pray for refugees, whether they're fleeing conflict, hunger, or persecution. Be with them, Lord. Strengthen them, uphold them. May they know your presence. And we pray that you will grant compassion to the leaders and the people of the nations where they end up. We pray for our own government. We ask that you will give them wisdom to do what's right in your sight as they wrestle with the many difficulties that our own country faces. And we pray for all those who are struggling as a result of those problems. People struggling with the cost of living crisis, people facing difficulties getting support that they need. People were facing difficult working conditions, or indeed lack of work. And those with physical or mental health problems. Those struggling against prejudice. And the many other problems facing the people of this country. We pray, Lord, for your blessing on everyone, that everyone will know your presence and your strength uplifting them. And we pray, Lord, for the members and people associated with our own fellowship. In particular, we think of Sally and her family. We think of Sarah and her son Harry. We think of Kath, Laura's sister. Wendy, Steve's sister. Pam, Christine's friend. And Jane's father. All of these people have needs, Lord. You know what they are, and you know how best to help them. And we pray, Lord, that in your wisdom, you will give them healing, peace, comfort, as appropriate. We pray too, Lord, for Charlie and Joe, Dave and Michelle, Phil and Liz. And we ask your blessing on all of them. And Lord, we pray that you will give us, as a fellowship and as individuals, wisdom. That you will help the leadership team and the search committee as they attempt to lead our fellowship and search for a new minister. We pray that you will make it apparent to all of us who that person is, and that you will make it apparent to that person that they will know when it's right to apply. And we pray, Lord, that you will fill each of us with your spirit, that you will make us beacons of your light and love to those around us. Help us to recognize ways that we can demonstrate your love in practical ways. And help us to live according to your will and to follow your path in all that we do. And shall we finish by saying the Lord's Prayer in whatever version or whatever language you feel comfortable with? So let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. And forgive us from sin, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The reading will be from Matthew chapter 11, verses 11 to 30. It can be found on page 10 on the church Bibles in the New Testament. Truly I tell you, among all who have ever been born, no one has been greater than John the Baptist. And yet the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. Since the time of John the Baptist, the kingdom of heaven has been subjected to violence, and violent men are taking it by force. For until John, and all prophets and the law foretold things to come, and John is the destined Elijah, if you will but accept it. If you have ears, then hear. How can I describe this generation? They are like children sitting in the marketplace and calling to each other. We piped for you and you would not dance. We lamented and you would not mourn. For John came, neither eating nor drinking, and people say, he is possessed. The Son of Man came, eating and drinking, and they say, look at him, a glutton and a drinker, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet God's wisdom is proved right by its results. Then he spoke of the towns in which most of his miracles had been performed, and denounced them for their impenitence. Alas for you, Chorazin, he said. Alas for you, Bethsaida. If the miracles performed in you had taken place in Tyre and Sidon, they would have been repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But it will be more bearable, I tell you, for Tyre and Sidon on the day of judgment than for you. As for you, Capernaum, will you be exalted to heaven? No, you will be brought down to Hades. For if the miracles performed in you had taken place in Sodom, Sodom would be standing to this day. But it will be more bearable, I tell you, for the land of Sodom on the day of judgment than for you. At that time, Jesus spoke these words. I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for hiding these things from the learned and wise and revealing them to the simple. Yes, Father, such was your choice. Everything is entrusted to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son but the Father, and no one knows the Father but the Son and those whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all who are weary and whose load is heavy. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble-hearted, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to wear, my load is light.
Thank you to Leslie and Julia, especially Julia, for reading quite a long and difficult passage in a language which isn't her native language. Bear that in mind. Very well done, Jenny. Thank you. So, before Ruth brings us our message, we're going to sing again. We were talking about wisdom earlier on, knowing God's wisdom. And this song is a request to God to see things as he does, to understand a little more about the wisdom of God. Because he always knows what should be done. He knows what the right way, the best way forward for us is. And as a result of that, all our days, we just sing his praise. So let's stand, if you're able, and sing, God, I Look to You.
To see things like you do, God, I look to you.
Please be seated. So, before we listen, Lord, we ask for a blessing on Ruth. She brings us your message. Give us ears that hear and hearts that are open to receive your message and respond to it. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Wisdom with people. Today we are looking at what James had to say in our dealings with other people. And I have been given four scriptures from James that we will be looking at. But first, I looked at the Gospels to see what they had to say about wisdom, and it is remarkably little. In verse 19 of the chapter that we read, the words say, God's wisdom is proved right by its results. Now, some translations render that verse, wisdom is justified by her children. Luke also records this same passage in his gospel, in his chapter 7 of Luke. In Luke chapter 2, he records that Jesus increased in wisdom and in years and in favor with God and man. And at one point, some of the people asked, where did this man, Jesus, get this wisdom? Now, James, in his letter, is seeking to hand on some of the wisdom that Jesus taught. James 2, verses 1 to 13 is the first section that we're looking at. And it reads, my brethren, hold no partiality as you hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. For if a man with gold rings and in fine clothes comes in, and a man in shabby clothes comes in, and you pay attention to the one in fine clothes and say, have a seat here, please, while you say to the poor man, stand there or sit at my feet. Have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? James then goes on to say that the poor man has been dishonored by your action. While it is the rich who oppress you and who drag you into court and who blaspheme the name by which you are called. James then goes on to continue and to show partiality is a sin, because we have broken the law to love our neighbor as ourselves, and we become guilty of the whole law. Now, let me just stop here and put this into some context. Firstly, James is dealing with how we should deal with strangers, wherever we meet them. Those who walk in through the doors of this church who are strangers to us, or people we meet in any context, anywhere. When we speak to them, it should be with dignity and with respect, whoever they are, rich or poor. Secondly, we should take off any rose-tinted glasses we look through when we read any of the letters in the New Testament. They had all the same sort of problems that we see today, including the letters dictated by Jesus to the seven churches in Revelation. Only two of them were commended by him, and the other five were warned to repent or judgment would come. The letters that Paul wrote to the churches that he knew and had founded contained warnings about gossip, criticism, favoritism, and so on. So how do we treat strangers that come in? Welcoming and friendly. But we do not need to know their life history on the first visit. Too many questions really puts people off. And the first time I came into this church, that happened to me. And I almost decided not to come back. That I was given almost the third degree. But it's not good. If someone speaks to them and a conversation does ensue, the rest of us need to stand away and let God do his work in that conversation. But ours is to pray that God will meet the need, whatever their reason for walking in through the church doors, that God will do his work in their life. Jesus never had favorites. He had close friends, but scripture tells us that he did not commit himself to any man, for he knew what was in man. The next part of James that we're looking at is found in chapter 4, and that's verses 11 and 12. And it reads, "Do not speak evil against one another, brethren. He that speaks evil against his brother speaks evil against the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver and one judge, he who is able to save and to destroy. But who are you that you judge your neighbor?" James here has moved from those who are strangers to those who are brethren or brothers and sisters in the fellowship. While thinking how to move on with this, the words of a song came to me that I heard in a service in the Baptist Church in Kenilworth 37 years ago. I eventually found the cassette in a shoebox. I still had it. On it is the song that had come to mind, called Healing Streams. The singer, Lou Lewis, was doing the weekend based on her testimony. All the songs were on the healing process that she had gone through in one way or another. Lou Lewis was a child of the manse. Her father was a pastor in a church in Cornwall, and she could not wait to escape. She gained a scholarship to the Royal College of Music and quickly became part of the swinging 60s scene in London. One day, a girl who was in the Christian Union gave Lou a card with her phone number on and said, "Just phone if you need help, anytime, anywhere." She slipped it into her pocket. Not long afterwards, she was at a party where drugs were being taken, and she took LSD for the first time. The result was catastrophic. Everyone in the house, when they saw what happened, fled, and she was left alone on her own. After a while, she came round and somehow remembered the card in her pocket. She managed to phone and gave the address before the drugs kicked in again. The young woman from the Christian Union was true to her word and traveled 2 hours across London, found the address, got her in the car and back across London, took her to her own flats where she cared for her, calling in a doctor and contacting her parents. After giving this part of her testimony, she sang the song that was part of the healing process called "I Know Where You're Coming From," spoken as Jesus speaking. Maybe it looks like a pace or two, but to someone it could feel like a mile. Many a secret battle in life has been hidden behind a smile. People judge so easily the surface things they see. But the Spirit of God searches for truth and sees things differently. Maybe it looks like an hour's work, but it could have taken years and years. Many a simple task in life has been crippled by doubts and fears. People judge so easily the surface things they see, but the Spirit of God searches for truth and sees things differently. So I'll lead you where you need to be led, and I'll feed you when you need to be fed, and I'll heal you when you're broken inside, so you don't have to hide, because I love you. I know where you're coming from. I know where you've been. I know the whole world loves a winner, but I love you when you fail to win. Anyone can love a superstar who's learned to play the part, but I'd rather have a poor man who opens up his heart. I'm sick of human cruelty and mindless empty talk. The world thinks it has grown to maturity, but it can hardly even walk. Judging things so quickly by the surface things they see, but the Spirit of God loves mercy and sees things differently. So I'm here when you call out my name, and I'll be with you when you're feeling in pain, and I'll come to you when you're crying, because I see that you're trying, and I love you. The words of this song, of course, are written from the viewpoint of someone who is being judged. And I cannot describe the effect it had on me 37 years ago in that meeting. Jesus said, "Judge not, that you be not judged, for the measure you give, is the measure you will receive." But Jesus goes on to say, first, take the log out of your own eye. Then you will see clearly to take the splinter out of someone else's eye. Paul also says a similar thing. He that is spiritual judges all things, but is himself judged of no man. We now come to the next passage of Scripture, which is James 5, verses 13 to 20. Is any among you suffering? Let him pray. Is any cheerful? Let him sing praises. Is any among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick man, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed any sins, they will be forgiven him. Therefore, confess your sins one to another, that you may be healed. Now, the letter of James was written about 55-57 AD, around 22 to 24 years after Jesus' death and the day of Pentecost. There was also persecution and famine in the Roman Empire during this period. So life was hard for many Christians. Is any among you suffering? James says. This would be a question of hardship rather than illness. Is any cheerful? Let him sing praises. Despite the circumstances, is any sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil. Way back in the book of Exodus, shortly after leaving Egypt, God revealed himself to his people as Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. But this declaration of God is preceded with a condition that says, if you will diligently hearken unto the Lord your God and do that which is right in his eyes, and give heed to his commandments, I will put none of the diseases upon you that I put on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord that heals you. Now, healing is a restoration of health. A miracle, on the other hand, is outside of the normal. I sometimes get asked, do you believe in faith healing? My reply is, I believe in divine healing. Though faith is a necessary part of receiving that healing which comes from God. Healing often goes with evangelism, and God gives gifts to support the ministry of evangelism. The gifts should never become an end in themselves, as we see in the ministry of Jesus and the period following the day of Pentecost, for it says signs and wonders followed the preaching of the word, and God added daily such as should be saved. Paul also wrote concerning gifts in 1 Corinthians 12. Paul wrote concerning the Holy Spirit giving gifts as he wills, gifts of wisdom, gifts of knowledge, of faith, gifts of healing, works of miracles, prophecy, discerning of spirits, various kinds of tongues and interpretation of tongues. All these are inspired by the Holy Spirit, who gives to each as he wills. To make the point at the end of this section, Paul asks, are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all have gifts of healing, speak in tongues? And the answer is no. Now that brings up the question, is the pattern put over by Paul in Corinthians contrary to that which James put over? And the answer to that is no. I am sure that when Anne Hibbert had a vision to start the well, she was led to start a work that would not work in the church setting. Something different was needed. We too as a fellowship need to pray and to seek God, to see what he wants us to do in this ministry and in other ministries. We already have a prayer chain, and when we need to ask for prayer support for healing, But we now need God to guide us as we take the next steps onward. After we've closed this service, Malcolm and myself will be available to pray with anyone who asks for prayer. And we are looking to doing this maybe once a month or so. In this passage, James emphasizes the need of prayer, giving Elijah as an example of fervent prayer to bring about the will of God. Nothing is done in the work of God without prayer. And if God so leads, fasting as well. Now, to come full circle, I started in Matthew 11 and quoted that verse about wisdom being justified by her children. And I just want to finish with the last verses in Matthew 11, because Jesus here really tells us who are the children of wisdom. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, said Jesus, and my burden is light. Now we're going to sing a hymn that encourages us to come to Jesus in prayer, to bring everything to him in prayer. What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer.
Thank you.
just say, before we just pray, that the first two things that we looked at this morning, where we have favoritism or this thing on judgment, you know, healing and ministries do not work if these things are in a church. And we would just ask that all of us, just search our hearts to see that we are clear. He that is spiritual can judge all things righteously and can judge all things well. And it's that that God blesses. Psalm 133, when brethren dwell together in unity, there the Spirit of God is outpoured. It flooded over the priest from right to the hem of his garment. And that's what we want to see among us, I'm sure. Shall we pray? Father, we just thank you for all of your word. Lord, those parts that are difficult, as well as those parts that we rejoice in and make us feel happy. But Lord, we do pray that you will just bring us into that place, Lord, where we can know, Lord, your anointing flowing through this place, coming through every heart, Lord, and flowing right through in blessing to everyone. Father, we just pray you'll bless every one of us this week. Lord, as we walk, whatever we do, wherever we go, whoever we meet, we pray, Father, that your Holy Spirit shall be upon us and that, Lord, we will indeed have your words to say, Lord, to all those that need a word. Bless, we pray, in Jesus' name we ask it. And now shall we say the grace together to one another. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.